Recently, the Woodcraft family came to visit us at the Lisa McPherson Trust. Lawrence Woodcraft and his daughters Zoe and Astra sat down to talk with Stacy Brooks.
Astra, why don't we start with your story? Tell us how you first got involved in Scientology and how old you were.
Well, when I was born and we lived in England, my mom was still an active member in Scientology. I don't think my dad was active. He didn't really want to be in it. Kind of went along with my mom. But so from as early as I can remember, we knew about Scientology. My mom would have us do contact assist, for example. Like if we got hurt, we had to say, I hit my hand on the table. I'd have to touch it back over and over and over till it felt better. These are like some of the things I remember growing up doing. And when I was about 5 or 6, she took us to an organization called St. Hill, which is the main organization for Scientology in England. And I received, I don't know, 10 or 12 hours, I think, approximately, of what's called auditing. And this was mainly the auditor, who's the person who delivers it to you, would tell me, look at that wall, go over and touch that wall, walk away from that wall, just over and over and over.
What was the purpose of that?
It's supposed to, from what I know, get you into what they say, like, present time, like, wake you up cause from being all, like...
But, I mean, you're 5 years old.
Yeah.
So, how did you
Well, I mean, I was 5 years old, and I thought this is what people do, you know, I didn't know that it was weird. And I just kind of went along with it. The thing with the contact assist where I had to touch it back, I hated that. I would just have to tell her it was better because I couldn't stop till it was better. And same with the sessions, the auditing, I couldn't stop until I said, oh, this is great, or I just had a, you know, I just had a realization.
So you mean at that
early age? I mean, at the age of 5 or 6, it was like, wow, that was fun. That would be my realization. I'd be able to stop. But yeah.
But I mean, at that early age, you were already learning how to pretend to be feeling better so that you could not have to do it anymore?
Yeah, because, I mean, okay, we're out shopping, and I trip or something. I have to, like, hit my knee into the floor over and over. Not painfully, but do it over and over. So embarrassing, you know? So, yeah, I'd be like, I'd do it twice, and I'd say, it's all better, it's all better. And then I'd have to be pretending that it's all better, that I'm not hurt anymore, because I don't want to be so embarrassed or made to do this thing over and over again. And it was the same with the auditing. And while I thought this is what, you know, people do, it still seemed... I didn't like it, really, but I just went along with it because, you know, my mom really wanted me to do it. She said it was so wonderful and stuff, so. Yeah. When I was 7, my mom's father died, and she went to Flag, which is in Clearwater in Florida, and that's like their highest level organization for delivering auditing. It's the most expensive, and he had left her some money, and she took that money to go and receive services from Scientology.
Do you know how much he'd left her?
Well, I know he left her a lot more in trust, but he left her like a fixed amount immediately for her to get of maybe $10,000 or $15,000. Mm-hmm. Not exactly sure. So she took that, and then she just called from Flag to us, we were in England, and said, I've joined the Sea Org and you're all gonna move out here. And she had already started working. She was already working there before she even told us and got our agreement.
And she's telling you and your dad.
And my brother, who's older. And she came back to get us, right? She came back, mm-hmm. right, yeah, to pack us all up and take us. And what she told me is we were going for a year for a vacation. We were going to stay in a big house with a lot of people, and it was going to be a lot of fun. So that's why it was okay to go, because I would have, I'm sure, been really upset. I was already upset leaving all my friends, leaving our house, leaving my family, but I thought we were going for a year. It was like a really long, really fun vacation. But there was no intention of that. We were obviously, it was for, you know, she signed a billion-year contract, because that's what you sign when you go in this organization. Mm-hmm. So that's what, you know, reality was. And we were told we were going to go to a really nice private school, that we were going to have a two-bedroom apartment, that they'd have time off every other week, like the day off to for us to go and, you know, do whatever we wanted to do, things like that. And so we all just up and moved to Clearwater in Florida. The first place we stayed was a motel that was very run down called the Quality Inn. It was, they kept the name. It, you know, they're all Quality Inn motels. They kept the name for
that.
They
call it the QI.
Yeah, they call it the QI, exactly. And we got one room, one motel room, just one room with a bathroom for my dad, my mom, my brother, my sister, and I. We had my brother, my sister, and I on a three-thing bunk bed, like three bunk beds high, and then my mom and my dad on a bed in the corner.
Is that common?
There it is.
It's common throughout
that my families are living all together in one room like that? The children with the parents?
Yeah. They later moved me out into a dorm, which I liked even less. Now they don't let the kids live with the parents. They stopped letting kids live with the parents, and the kids had to all live by themselves, and the parents would have probably rather had the kids with them. Or, you know, like a two-room place with the kids in one room and them in another, but the kids were all moved out. And for about a year, from what I remember, we were in this room. My brother then got recruited to join the serenization.
How old was he?
I think. Mm-hmm. So he was not in the room anymore, so it's me, my sister, my mom, and my dad.
He was recruited to join the serenization when he was 12?
12 or 13, yeah. Their entry program, like kind of like boot camp, mm-hmm. is called the EPF, the Estates Project Force, and he was on that for a long time. It's supposed to take a couple weeks, and I remember he was on it for like 6 months mm-hmm. or longer. Or maybe the whole time we were there, I don't remember.
I didn't realize they recruited kids at such an early age.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, he was, because he went in pretty soon after we got there, from what I remember, and he was 12 when we got there, so he could have been 12 or 13. Mm-hmm. And they were supposed to take family time every evening. At dinner time, they were supposed to get like an hour to spend with the kids. Mm-hmm. My mom hardly used to ever come. My dad would come, but my mom would hardly ever come. And I don't remember her ever taking a day off, maybe one day. I think one day I remember we went to an amusement park. I'm sure she took, you know, maybe a couple or 3 days off while we were there, but I don't really remember any of it. My dad would take some time off. Then they sent my dad to work on the ship that they bought called the Free Winds.
So you didn't see him at all?
Didn't see him at all, and then didn't see my mom because she wouldn't come for family time. And she'd get home, you know, usually I think 2 or 3 in the morning.
So how old were you at this point?
I lived in Florida from when I was 7 till when I was 9.
So and who is watching you while your parents
are
gone?
They have a thing called the Cadet Org, which is for the young kids whose parents are in the Sea Org. So in the morning I go to school. We didn't get sent to a private school, as promised. We went to the public school. So I go to school and then get back, and then we would do work like cleaning and other little jobs. And they had like one adult or two adults watching all of us. And then we go to bed. Well, after about a year, I got moved out of my parents' room because they moved all the kids into dorms. And then I slept on a couch the rest of the time. We were in another motel room with maybe 4 or 5 other kids. I think it was 4 kids and 1 adult lived in the room I was living in. And there weren't any beds, so I slept on a couch the whole time. And then, so after we'd been there about 2 years, my mom got transferred to Los Angeles to, like, middle management. And my dad, so we all moved out here. My dad took a leave of absence because he had debts, and you can't pay off your debts if you work there because you only make $30 a week.
Right.
Actually, when we were in Florida, at one point we went back to England to handle our visas. We had to go back there, and we were there for a week or two, and my brother, my sister, my dad, actually, she was too young to really know, myself, my brother, and my dad wanted to stay so badly. My dad was even saying we could work at the organization in England, just let us stay, we want to stay. I was crying because ever since I got into Florida, I would walk around crying, just crying and crying and crying and crying. I hated it. And the woman who ran the children, who was in charge of the children, was really mean. She used to yell at me. You know, I locked myself in the bathroom one day because I didn't want her to get near me. I was terrified. I hated it there so much I thought we were there for vacation.
Yeah.
And instead we're in this motel. We used to put little cockroach traps down, and in the morning there would be like 50 cockroaches in it. That's how this place was. It was like repulsive, and you know, my mom had lied, and I even knew then, you know, because I remember she said, we're just going to go, it's a vacation, we're going to live in a big house, a bunch of people, it's going to be a lot of fun, and I was so upset. And we begged to stay. We begged her and begged her and begged her. We said, we want to stay. We were crying. She said, no, we have to go back. And so we went back. So then I was in the Cadet Org in Los Angeles. And when we first got here, we were put in a one-room, like, studio apartment that was gross.
And where was that?
This was just in, like, a building. It was just rented for us. Mm-hmm. but it was really like in a bad area and it was really gross and just like run down. We were there for about a month, I think, and then my dad finally just went and got us an apartment.
Now, what year was this?
88.
Okay.
And I was 9. So then I was in the cadet org in Los Angeles, and for about the first year I was there, and how it would work is in the morning they had their own school. They like made their own school, but our teacher wasn't an actual teacher. They're just trained Scientology supervisors, but they don't have to have any formal education, they don't even have to have a high school diploma, they're just the people who happen to get that job. And we would be bused out to this school and we'd sit all in a classroom. We wouldn't get lessons. The teacher wouldn't teach us anything because that's against the rules in Scientology. The teacher's not allowed to explain anything to you. You're only allowed to read and clear the words you don't understand, like look them up in a dictionary.
So what kind of things would you read?
I don't even remember. Like math, I would just like read a math book or do like flashcard drills and then make clay representations of what I was reading, things like that.
Did you learn anything?
I don't remember. I don't remember learning much. I don't remember any math that I learned. We weren't taught history. We weren't taught science. We weren't taught anything like that.
What were you taught?
I remember doing math, doing flashcards over and over to learn. I learned my multiplication tables. I think that's the only thing I remember that I actually learned. And they had these things like check sheets where they'd say like you'd have to do each thing and check it off and say like read this page, make a clay representation of what you read, have someone give you a checkout on it, which means they ask you all like the words out of what you just read and you have to tell the person exactly what they mean, and if you don't you have to go look them up in the dictionary and do it over again. So that's like how we learned. If we acted up in class we just got thrown out.
And then what would
then we just go sit out and play on the field and cause trouble or do whatever we wanted to do. So it wasn't like school. It was like killing time, really. After school, we'd be bused back and we'd be put to work. We had to go to the basement of one of their main buildings where they had just mounds and mounds and rooms of filing. Like filing of letters people had written into Scientology, all kinds of stuff. And we had to file it. And we had to like sort it all and file it all. And
and this is your 9?
Yeah, I was 9. And I think we did that till about 9 at night, 8:30 or 9, 9:30.
Wait, you're going to school in the morning.
Yeah.
And you're getting out of school at...
By the time we got bused back, because the school they had rented was like a 45-minute to an hour drive away. So by the time we got back, I think it was about 5, and then we'd have dinner. I'd usually try and have dinner with my dad, and then I'd have to go back and work.
So you would have to come to the cadet org and have dinner with her there?
I think he used to pick me up or something.
I think, yes, I used to drop by, pick her up, and
I never wanted to go back, but I'd always tell him I had to go back, because they said I got in trouble. Like, a couple times I didn't go back after dinner, and I got in big trouble. So I'd be like, oh, you have to take me back. I want to go back, you know. Mm-hmm. It was at that, you know, at such an early age, I already learned to, like, lie to my dad because otherwise I'd get in trouble.
So you're working, you're going to school, you're having dinner, then you're going to work until 9 at night.
Yeah.
And you're 9 years old.
Yeah. And then we'd have to go to sleep on these cots on the floor. They were like a little metal frame, maybe like 4 feet long and like this wide. And with like canvas, and we'd go to sleep on those, and they had like these big blankets, and they'd cut them up, and we'd all get a piece of blanket, and we'd sleep on these cots or on the floor when we ran out of cots, until my mom came and picked me up, and she would come at like midnight, 11 or midnight. It was very strict there too, you know, lots of rules, lots of people, you know, they had an adult who was in charge of handling our ethics, which handling us when we did something wrong, and she would yell at us and stuff. And at one point, I think I'd been there for maybe a year, and several things happened. There was a boy there who's really unhappy, and we had this like little building. There was a little building with like two big rooms in it, and there was a fence all around it with like a front and back courtyard, like concrete courtyard. And there was a billboard like next to it, and the boy got so upset one day he climbed up the billboard and said he was going to jump off.
How old was he?
He was maybe a couple years older than me. So I see this boy threatening to like commit suicide, so that kind of scared me. And then another boy threw a cockroach at me and punched me. So at that point, I got really upset, and I told my dad I'm not going back. I called him. I said, come pick me up. And I said, I'm not going back. And he, of course, didn't want me to go back. I was always the one saying, I have to go back, you know, making it sound like it was all wonderful. Mm-hmm. But I refused to go back. And I told my mom what happened, and I said, I'm not going back. And she said, you have to go back. You have to go back. And for weeks and weeks and weeks, or months, she pressured me, and she said, just come in and speak to someone. We'll work it out. Come back. Come back. And I said, no, I'm not going to come back. But I did continue to go to their school because I had no other school to go to. So I go to the school. Then when I got off school, I'd just go home to our apartment. But they kept saying, you can't keep going to the school. You can only go to the school if you're in the cadet org afterwards and you work. Otherwise, you're not allowed to go to school. So I'm not sure exactly how. I think I kept going to the school for maybe four to 6 months. And then they wouldn't let me go anymore. So my dad enrolled me in a private school, which was a Scientology school at my mother's insistence. She insisted I had to go to
Scientology school.
It was called Ability Plus. Mm-hmm. And this school wasn't really an improvement over the last school. There was two classrooms, one for the young children and one for the older children. The teachers weren't necessarily credentialed teachers. We were taught with the same technology of study. With, you can't have the teacher explain things to you, you have to read, you have to make clay, you have to clear your words in the dictionary. We use the same check sheets even that we had in the other place. And I think I learned a little bit more there, but I didn't learn much there either. And no one had ever graduated from this school. Nobody.
What do you mean?
No one had ever graduated school, going to this school.
Whatever happened to the kids? Happened to them?
They grew up and they joined the Sea Org mainly, I think.
So these were all
14 or 15 or 16. It's all Scientology kids.
Mostly parents were Sea Org.
I don't think so, no. But the kids would join the Sea Org anyway. They'd be recruited. Or they would, go on full-time training in Scientology. Not be in the Sea Org, but be training to be an auditor. Or they would take their GED, like their high school equivalency exam. Or, I don't know, they just never really got to the point of, no one had ever graduated, because the teacher's own daughter was always saying she was going to be the first person to graduate from the school. But they didn't even have a way to graduate people. Neither did they at the school I went to in the Sea Org, because that wasn't their purpose. Their purpose was just to school you to fill the legal requirement until you're old enough to go in the Sea Org. Because when I went into the cadet org, I had to sign the billion-year contract saying I agreed to be in the Sea organization when I'm old enough. Otherwise, I wouldn't be allowed there. And then I stopped going there, and I started going to another school called Larry Dennison's Academy, and it was just in the morning from 8 to 12, and Sear kids did go there at the time. And that was even worse. It was his apartment, and we all sat in there at tables and, like, read books and stuff and just did nothing, really. Watched TV.
So by now, how old are you?
Like 13. I went there for a few months and then stopped going there because it was useless. And then I was on course at the Celebrity Center. I started a course there. And I had turned 14, and while I was on course, these two recruiters from Bridge Publications, which is a Sea Org org, they say it's not. It's like it's incorporated by itself, but it's the organization that makes the books and things like that for Scientology. And really, you know, everyone in there is a Sea Org member. Mm-hmm. So they say it's not, but it is. So they came to see me. And they told me if I went to work there, I'd get paid minimum wage, which would be, for a 14-year-old, you know, it's like $300 a week. It's a lot of money. Mm-hmm. That I wouldn't have to wear a uniform. Because many people had tried to recruit me before for this year, like from the age of 12. And I always said no, I didn't want to. But they said I'd get paid all this money. I wouldn't have to wear a uniform. It was really fun. And these guys were young. They were charismatic. They were good-looking. And they sweet-talked me into it. Plus, I had always been very upset that I had let my mom down. And I knew she would be just like, ecstatic if I joined. So I did. I knew in the back of my mind that I was making a mistake, but I just kind of, you know, like, I was just kind of pushed along into it.
I mean, generally
speaking, they told me that the only reason I was not joining was my reactive mind, which was controlling me and telling me not to do it because your reactive mind stops you from doing good things, and this was a good thing. And I couldn't confront and take the responsibility to do it because of my reactive mind. So I should be bigger than my reactive mind and go and do it. So then I was like, oh yeah, I don't want my reactive mind to control me, so I better do it. Mm.
They use virtually any tactic from yelling to, they'll show you like newspaper clippings of horrible things that have happened in the news and say, like, we try to stop this, and ever since we've been working on this area, you know, the crime has gone down and we've helped all these families, and you think, oh God, you know, I'd be such a horrible person if I didn't go in here and help them out in this, and I would just be irresponsible and not doing my duty towards all of mankind.
That's exactly
that sort of thing.
And they also show you this policy that L. Ron Hubbard wrote saying, and it was written in 1970, and it said, in 30 years, the planet won't support human life. And then they told us the only reason it still is supporting human life, because this was in, I don't know, 93, so we had 7 years to go, but the only reason it's made any improvement is because of Scientology, and if we don't keep going, the planet isn't even going to be able to support life. So you have half of me going, like, I can't let my reactive mind control me, and half of me going, I have to help mankind. And then part of me was going, oh wow, I'm going to get paid money and don't have to wear a uniform and it's going to be so fun, and these, you know, guys are going to, I'm going to work with them. They said I get to work with them. So the next day I started, and I started what's called the Estates Project Force, which is boot camp. And my schedule was something like get up at 6:30, breakfast at 7. 7:30 we had like a muster, like a staff meeting thing, and we had to, you know, drill and do military marching and stuff. And then I had to run around and empty trash cans till 8 o'clock. And then I had to study Scientology material for 5 hours straight, just like what your attitude should be like about ethics, about things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Then the rest of the day was work. We'd have half an hour for dinner. The rest of the day was work. And I had to clean pots and pans, mop floors, clean out a broken, clogged toilet.
What about school?
No school.
What do you mean?
No school.
You're 14 years old.
Yeah, but you don't. They sent me to school afterwards. Not very much anyway, but I'll get into that. But no school while you're on the Estates Project Force. Just the 5 hours of Scientology study. Some people were on for months. I was on for 2 weeks because I was able to study the courses quickly. But for those 2 weeks, the rest of the time I was working, and then we'd do drilling, more marching.
Drilling of?
Like, they'd have, like, the code of a Sea Org member, and we'd have to repeat it and learn it so we knew it verbatim.
Mm-hmm.
We'd have to march, we'd have to salute, things like that. So that went on for 2 weeks. I finished. I went to start working at Bridge Publications. The day I started working there, they told me, you're being temporarily transferred. And I said, no. I was like, no, I'm not. And they're like, you have to. You have no choice because you have no staff status. You have to complete some courses before you have any rights as a staff member, which even when you complete the courses, they can still transfer you.
Of course, the people that are telling you this aren't the same people that recruited you.
No, no. But you, they said, it's just temporary. It's 2 months. You'll be right back here. So I agreed to it. I said, okay, I can take it for 2 months. Then I had to wear a uniform. And I went to work as the International Justice Chief's administrator. I was like their secretary. So the International Justice Chief is the one who is responsible for declaring people suppressive persons, which means, you know, no one in Scientology can speak to them anymore if they've done something wrong. Doing committees of evidence, which is Scientology's way of, like, it's like the court system in Scientology, et cetera. So I was in charge of writing letters and putting all this stuff together and things like that. And I did that for a couple months. And then while I was working there, they said, you're being permanently transferred to the International Training Organization. Now I knew, see, each organization is separate, but it's all part of the C organization, so it's all one, but each one's separate, and they have to make their own money and support their own staff. So I knew this organization particularly, they weren't making any money. The staff were eating refried beans and rice every day. That's a thing in the C. If you're in trouble or you're not, like, making money, you eat refried beans and rice every day, and water, and that's all you get.
They won't give you anything else?
It's called the rice and beans thing. They
so they were on that meal every day, and the staff were getting paid $15 a week, I think it was. They were on like half pay or quarter pay.
This is at the International Training Org?
Yeah. So I said, there's no way I'm going to work there. I've done nothing wrong, and all of a sudden I'm going to be paid nothing and have to eat beans and rice. So they said, you have no staff status, you have no choice. My mom, it's funny actually, because I thought I was going to be able to work with my mom or close to her.
And where was she working?
Well, she was working in that building that I got transferred to. But as soon as I joined, she got sent away on what they call a mission to go and handle an organization in Mexico. So she was down there the whole time. So I tried to call her to get her to help me, but I could never get through to her. And she wouldn't have been able to help me anyway because it's, you know, out of her jurisdiction. So I was refusing and refusing, and they said, you have no choice, and I was going to get into big trouble, so I had to agree and go along with it.
And what would big trouble have meant?
It would have meant lower conditions.
What does that mean?
Yeah, you get, like, penalized. You have to do amends, do work on your own time to make up for what you've done. You have to get everyone's permission to come back into the group. You have to, you know, do, like, soul searching and find out, like, what you've done wrong and what kind of person you really should be. And it's horrible. It's like you get this, like, label put on you. Like, you're a bad person until you handle this.
Uh-huh.
And people know. And you can get other penalties. You can't get any time off. Your meal breaks get shortened. You can have some of your pay taken away, things like that. You know, all your privileges, what little you have, are gone. So so no one likes that.
Yeah.
So
I can imagine.
So I agreed, and I had no choice, and I became the receptionist. And I was the receptionist for about 6 months. And during this time, I started having a relationship with a man there named Jason Merrill, and he was 7 years older than me. But you're not allowed to do anything. They have a policy. You're not allowed to do anything other than kiss before you get married. If you do anything else, you're in really, really big trouble, like going on the Rehabilitation Project Force, which is hard labor for several years. So you can't do anything. So you're pushed immediately to get married. As soon as you start any kind of relationship, you're told you better get married before you get in trouble. You have to get married, you have to get married. So in December...
Didn't someone like see you in the hallway kissing him and they said, get married? Or
yeah. Something. You better get married. You better get married now. So
why is it like that, do you think?
They have the idea, they have policies on it, that the whole area of like relationships and sex is very messed up, is very aberrated, they call it. And that people aren't responsible enough to deal with it. And they don't want to look bad as a church, having people having sex. I mean, I can understand, I was 14, I shouldn't have been doing anything anyway. So if they had a rule that the minors can't do that or something, that's a great rule, you know. The minors should not be going around having sex. But it was for everybody. And it also was like nothing more than kissing, so you weren't allowed to experiment, you weren't allowed to grow up, you weren't allowed to do anything if you wanted to, like, do anything, you had to get married first.
Mm-hmm.
So that's also ridiculous. The policy states, that L. Ron Hubbard supposedly wrote, states that it's for public relations reasons, that no one can do anything until they get married. So a month after I turned 15, I was off to Vegas and got married, because I had
15.
No choice. Yeah. And also, before you get married, you have to live in a room with other people. I was in a room that was maybe 8 by 10 feet, maybe 8 by 12 feet, with 6 people. That was where we lived. We had three bunk beds. We had three bunk beds here, three bunk beds here, and a dresser in the middle. That's all that fit. And then a dresser over here, and that's all that fit in the room. And it didn't have a bathroom. We had to go to like the main shower hall and take a shower. So that's horrible. If you get married, you have to wait, and then you get your own room. So that's like a luxury, your own room. So it's another reason to get married. So so a month after I turned 15, I was married, and my husband was 22. And then I got transferred to another job, which was called the Master at Arms. And that's the person who is in charge of ethics.
That's called an ethics officer.
Yeah, an ethics officer, like enforcing ethics on people, like assigning people lower conditions, making them do amends, doing inspections, finding the bad people in the organization, etc.
And was this in the International Training Org still? Mm-hmm.
And also, the International Training Org trained people in Scientology's administrative technology from the lower organization, so I was also responsible for all the students.
Uh-huh.
When I, because then I got promoted to the person who was over that entire department of like security and ethics for the staff and the students.
And what's that called?
That's called the Director of Inspections and Reports. So my very first assignment when I came onto that job was, there was a man who was about 40 years old. He was a staff member. His wife had been sent to Florida. She'd been gone for a year or two on training, and he hadn't seen her, and he had admitted that he had masturbated or been masturbating.
And where did that come up? How did that information come out?
He got in trouble for something and he admitted it. Or he was getting a confessional and admitted it. That's how it comes up. And so I was 15, and he came to the office and I had to handle him. So it's like the first day, I think, or the second day I started working on this job, and I had to tell him that he couldn't masturbate. I had to have him read a policy where L. Ron Hubbard says masturbating is bad, and I had to get him to figure out how not to masturbate. And
you're 15 years old?
Yeah, I'm 15. I was so embarrassed. I didn't even know what I was doing, and I'm telling this 40-year-old man to not masturbate, and it was the most embarrassing thing in the world. No one's allowed to masturbate. Masturbating is a big issue. You get in big trouble. You won't get promoted. No masturbating. You know, even if your wife's gone or you're a young kid or anything, no masturbation is allowed. It's really frowned upon. You're considered aberrated. You're considered, like, messed up if you masturbate.
And this is in policy by Hubbard?
Yeah.
In books, too?
Yeah, he says masturbation is bad because it stimulates sexual pictures. I never really understood what that meant, but it was really bad.
Whatever.
Yeah, it was a really bad thing to do. So that was always a big issue, and I had to handle plenty of people for that over, you know, the period of working there, but that was the first one. And then I had to handle a girl who wanted to leave, to convince her to stay. I had to handle a lot of people for a lot of things, but some of the main things were staff members who wanted to leave. It was a big issue.
How did you convince them to stay?
Just get them to realize that they were wrong. You know, have them read policies where it says, if you leave the Sea Org, you're a degraded being. You know, and these are policies L. Ron Hubbard's written. If you leave the Sea Org, you're a degraded being. The only reason you leave is because of your own withholds and your own crimes. And you'd wear people down. You have to get them to go into confessionals and admit what they've done, read policies saying that they're wrong, tell them, yell at them. As soon as you say you want to leave, you're put on to hard labor. You're not allowed to leave until you've got permission. It takes 6 months to a year. And they're just worn down over time because all the staff sneer at you. You're referred to as a degraded being.
How did you personally feel about if somebody came to you and said they wanted to leave?
I wanted more than anything to say, by all means, go. Take me with you.
Why didn't you?
Because I get in such big trouble. Because if I just up and left, my family would never speak to me again, my mom, my grandma, my brother. So I wasn't about to do that. If I sided with them and said, go ahead and leave, they wouldn't be able to leave. And I'd be in big trouble. You know, I'd be in ethics. You'd just be
doing hard labor.
It's very hard to describe, but you're like in constant fear of people finding out about what you're thinking. Of people like knowing that you've done something wrong, and you don't want anyone, you're just in fear all the time of people finding out about you, of people finding out the thoughts you've had. If you think about leaving, then you have to withhold that forever, and if you tell them, then you're in big trouble. And
so how did you deal with having all these thoughts that you didn't want anybody to know?
Well, I did get to the point where I just wanted to kill myself, because I felt I was so trapped. I couldn't leave. I couldn't possibly leave. And I couldn't stand to stay, and I felt I had all these things I wasn't telling people that I had done that were wrong, and I was such a bad person. And
Did you have any friends that you could confide in?
I never told my husband. We were married for 4.5 years, and I never told him once that I was unhappy, and he never knew that I was unhappy.
Why? What were you afraid he would do?
He would have to report it immediately. He'd have to report what I told him. Any friends, he'd have to report what I told him. You know, say I had told my dad wouldn't have reported it. But then I would have this withhold, as they call it, that I had done something really wrong, and then I'd end up having to tell. Because they have things called e-meters. It's like a lie detector. And you really think that these will find out what you've done wrong. So you're in constant fear of them finding out. So you can't even say, well, I can think these things and not tell them. You're in constant fear that they're gonna find out what you're thinking.
But you were holding these fairly high posts, so you must have done a really good job of appearing to be a very good
CEO. You know, when I ended up leaving, people were very surprised because I was considered a great staff member. I produced a lot. I got awards, you know, and everyone was just shocked because I did do a very good job of, I just learned how to, like, not say anything. And I have trouble now, like, expressing my feelings, telling people how I feel. I'll get upset and I won't say anything.
Yeah.
Because that's what I've learned to do for like 5 years. or longer, really. But and I have to like force myself to say, well, actually, you know, that upset me, because I think there's something wrong. I don't ever want to say I'm upset or I'm having bad feelings or anything.
Right. What about you, Zoe?
I was just gonna say that in the CR, you start to police your own thoughts. Like, you think, oh, and you I can't think that, can't think of that thought, but then you do, but then you're like, oh no, and you kind of like slap yourself around mentally. I mean, it's put
really
me under
weird.
So much stress, like
trying not to have these
thoughts.
You could
have a relaxing day and just go to the park, but all the time you're still struggling mentally to not think certain things and to, you know what I mean, like it just, you could never be at rest or relax about your own mind.
Like, I could never admit to myself that I actually didn't want to be there. I'd say 90% of the staff there, if you said to them, if the management said to them, you guys can leave right now, no strings attached, you won't get in trouble, they'd go. They'd just be gone.
I spent like 2 years in the Sea Org, and I had a similar experience. You know, I just wasn't happy. But I would think to myself, I would look at my wife, I would look at other Sea Org members, and I would think, well, they're happy.
Yeah.
You know, they're on purpose.
Yeah.
So I remember at least two occasions I went to ethics, and I just made a clean front of it, and I thought, they will fix me so that I'm on purpose with the program and happy. And I would just, I confess everything. I say, I'm not happy. There's something wrong with me. Would you give me something that would fix me and make me happy?
Wow.
And I did that on two occasions.
I would never.
And they would say,
that.
Yes, you do these conditions, you know, work through these lower conditions, do extra mess work, you know, and then they'll give me a whole bunch of references to read. Just read through all these and you'll be fixed. And I'll work through this program and work through it. And like, I wasn't feeling better. And then eventually, I would just fake it and say, okay, yeah, I've read all those programs, I feel better now, I'm ready to continue. And then it would go back to worse than it was, because then I thought, well, I can't go and turn myself in, there's no hope, what do I do now?
Yeah.
And you're more trapped.
Yeah.
So it's a horrible, horrible
feeling. It was similar for me, because I never went and admitted it, but so many people had admitted it to me, and I'd given them those programs and those handlings to do, and they would be happy for a while, they'd do just what he did, say, okay, I'm fine, and then a month later, wouldn't be able to take it anymore, and come back and say, I want to leave again. So I knew it was the same thing that was going to happen to me. So I was just hoping that one day it would change, because I thought it was something wrong with me.
Mm-hmm.
There must be something wrong with me. If everyone else here is so happy and doing so well, and this is such a great thing, and we're making the whole planet, we're saving mankind, something must be wrong with me.
But what's interesting is you're acting like you're fine because you don't want anybody to think there's anything wrong with you, and you're looking around seeing everybody else acting fine. And you're believing that they really feeling fine, but they're probably.
Well, that's why I said if you said to the staff, go ahead, leave, you won't get a free litter bill, you won't get in trouble, you won't be looked down upon, you can just leave now, they'd be gone.
I remember hearing about cases like that all the time. People would be like, oh, they're roller coastering.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
that's
they're roller coastering, or like PTS, or like they're someone's.
The potential trouble.
Someone's
source.
giving them these ideas and stuff, so. I would always hear that, like, someone says they want to leave, and then they change their mind, and it would go on for, like, years, and then people say, we need to get them just finally handled and get them decide to stay. I mean, give me a break. They're ridiculous. They're stupid people. It was like that. That was the attitude.
Another thing that I was afraid of is they have an expression called external influences, and that's anybody, your family, friends, or otherwise who aren't in the Sea Org who speak to you and in any way have an effect on you that may make you want to leave. Or even if you're not saying you want to leave, you're perfectly happy, but if they're giving you gifts, talking to you more than once in a blue moon, spending time with you if you get the day off, then they're an external influence.
External to the Sea Org?
External
to Scientology?
They could be a Scientologist.
But external to the Sea Org.
They're very, because they have a hard time getting new staff, and then they have people leaving. So they're like, they got to hold on to the people they have. And that's a big thing there, external influences. They regularly do investigations to find out who has an external influence on their lines. My dad was considered an external influence, especially because he had been in the Sea Org and left.
Mm.
He was still considered a Scientologist, but one of my seniors used to say, your external influence called for you. Meaning my father. I was told later on, a year before I left, I was told on no uncertain terms, I cannot see him. I'm not allowed to see him unless I am getting him to go back into this organization. I am not allowed to see him.
Well, now let me just clarify this here. you were out of the Sea Org.
I was out of the Sea Org, but I was.
But you were still
I was still an active Scientologist.
Yeah.
I was still paying money for services, so I was.
Yeah. But they have a policy.
I was part
that
of the program still.
Anybody who leaves the Sea Organization is a degraded being. Whether or not they continue in Scientology, they could continue in Scientology, they could give a bunch of money, they could do everything. They're considered a degraded being. There's kind of a red flag over their head. So if Astra's not doing well, red alert, external influence. Sea Org doesn't want them to leave till they've gotten them to confess to all their crimes, searched all their belongings to make sure they're not taking anything, and signed an affidavit saying they'll never sue the church, they'll never speak badly out against the church, and that everything they did was wrong and everything the church did was wonderful. And by that time, they've hoped to have convinced them to stay anyway, but if they had to leave, they want all of that done first. So there was a couple who twice left and then came back. They left without permission, they came back. So they were considered a very high security risk. My job was...
Now, who were they? Do you remember?
Sean Brennecke and his wife. I forget her name. So they had left twice. Just they'd gone to, like, to the, his parents' house, like, 30 minutes away. But now they were considered a high security risk, even though they came right back. It was my responsibility to make sure they didn't do it again, or that anybody else didn't do it. I had to have them under 24-hour security watch.
What does that mean?
That means 24 hours a day, someone is with them making sure they don't go anywhere.
And who did you use to
watch them?
No one
was allowed to do it because it's very strict in Scientology that if it's not your job, you don't do it in the Sea Org. There's like policies on it. Only do your own job. That was nobody's job. There was no job to do that.
Right. So.
But it fell under me. So I'd have to convince people to do it, convince people to let their junior do it, etc. But at one point, I couldn't find anybody to do it. So I had to put a mattress outside their door and tie my arm to their door. So that if they left, it would wake me up. It would, like, pull my arm and wake me up.
So you're sleeping like this?
Mm-hmm. For, I don't know, a while, a week or two. And so that was pretty ridiculous.
So you didn't want this to happen to you?
No.
I can understand that.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I was doing it to people, and I regret, like, everything I ever did.
Did you feel bad about it at the time?
I did. I felt really bad. I so badly wanted to be like the person who opens the cage and lets the birds fly away, you know what I mean? I wanted to let them go so badly, and I wanted to go with them. And the people who did finally get permission to go, I was like thinking, take me. I was jealous of them. Not jealous, but...
Envious.
Envious, yeah, that's the right word. I was so envious, like, oh my God, they're free, you know? And they're so brave to have persevered through all of that, you know, and I never thought I could do it. And anyway, then there was a reorganization, and I became the ethics officer and then the director of inspections reports for the entire building, which is like 600 staff.
And what was the name of that post?
I was the ethics officer, then they had the Department of Inspections and Reports. I was the director of inspections and reports. For this, now it was called the Flag Liaison Office. International Training Org became part of it. But this is more like 400, 600 staff.
That's the FOLO.
No, that's the FOLO is the same, but lower. There's like a FOLO in every continent, like a FOLO in Europe.
Yeah.
This was the FLO, which is like the senior organization to
over
all of the FOLOs.
This. Okay.
They're like lower management.
So
we were middle management. Well, I was also the security chief that fell under me. The security
for the flag
chief
liaison office.
For the flag liaison office. And this is the Hollywood Guarantee building on Hollywood Boulevard.
HGB.
They have and they have the life exhibition there. And then they have the whole of middle management is there. And then OSA is there. But because OSA is very sensitive, Office of Special Affairs, you know, they deal with all the legal things. So the church, I wasn't the director of inspections and reports for that because you have to have special clearance and that's all like super confidential.
But
I was the security chief for them.
But
we did security for the whole building.
Is the international level of management?
They're like they're considered upper middle management.
So it's Wyzant and
Smyant.
Yeah,
it is international to that degree. The only thing above it is RTC.
Right.
And but they are Church of Scientology International. Their legal term
the
is
people
Church
at the building where you
yeah,
were.
Yeah,
right.
That's Church Scientology International.
Right.
So.
So that's a big job.
Yeah, and it was me and a girl younger than me who was about 14 for the whole building and like three or four security guards. It was also my job to collect all the statistics every week. And there were a good 10 or 15 people at a time who wanted to leave, and I was responsible for watching them, handling them to stay. There's policies, I guess, for public relations reasons that say if you want to leave, you have to be shipped out within 24 hours.
Mm-hmm.
But no one ever leaves in under like...
Oh, I've never heard of anyone leaving within 24 hours.
No, no one ever does.
Never, not even like... I've never even heard of a month, but maybe, but...
6 months to a year, and you're lucky. You know, 2 years sometimes. Because one of the main reasons is they're trying to break you down, and another reason is you have to get a confessional before you go, and there's no one to give the confessionals. No one had that job.
So how did you deal with it?
They'd have to convince an auditor to do it, convince someone to take some time to do it. The organization is so bureaucratic, it's so ridiculous, because there's all these jobs, and there's all these policies, and you have to do this, you have to do this, you have to do this, but you can't do this, but you have to do this, but you can't do this. And there's an expression, make it go right. You can't say, I can't do this because there's no one there to do it. It's like, make it go right. You have to do it anyway. You could get an order or like a program written, and it says, you know, I don't know, set up computers in this office and set up a whole computer system. But there'll be no money to do it. But that's no excuse. So you try and get permission for money, and you're told no money. There's no money to do it. But you still have to do it. So you have people yelling at you saying, do it, and then you try and get the money, and they say, there's no money. And everyone is just like going round and round in circles. It's the most unbelievable thing you've ever seen.
You're ordered to do it, there's no money, so you say, so they come in and they say,
make it
go
right.
You have to do this, and you say, well, I didn't get the money approved. And they say,
your counterintention.
Yeah, yeah, they say you're reasonable, which to us now sounds like a good thing to be.
You're reasonable.
But in there, it's
not. They even preach like you should be unreasonable.
Because they have a policy, suppressive reasonableness. So if you take an excuse for something, like there's no money, you're being suppressively reasonable.
Or if you're being logical.
Very bad thing to
be. Yeah, exactly.
Or they'd get an order, you know, you get an order, send these people out to this other organization to handle them because they're not doing well. But it was no one's job to go. So they'd have to find people to go. But there's also a policy that says don't do anything other than your job. Don't let your juniors do anything other than their job. So you'd say there's no one to go and these people can't go because it's off policy. Then there's another policy that says you cannot use policy to stop. So you're using policy to stop, you're being suppressively reasonable, and you're being counterintention. And people spend months trying to like find someone to do something, and there's hardly any new people coming in, and there's people leaving, so you know.
How did you stay?
The International Training Org, when I first got there, had like 100 staff, and a year and a half later, had like 40.
There's always constant struggle and arguments between the staff because someone can say, oh, look, I'm right, look at this policy, and the person says, yeah, well, I'm right, look at this policy, and they conflict, the policies conflict each other, and the third person can say, and if they're higher in post, most people will, like, listen to them and say, oh, no, look, I have this policy here, but you know, you could always find a policy to conflict that one. I mean, doesn't make sense.
I always remember there's another policy in which there's a thing called an admin scale, and there's like a list of the importances of things. And one of the most important things is purpose, and then policy comes below purpose.
Yeah, you're like, so then, how do you make it?
Then if you had something to do and you said, but that's counter to this policy, they'd say, you're using policy to stop because purpose is higher than policy.
Oh, yeah.
But then if you follow the purpose without the policy, you're off policy. So you're just spinning like a top.
And it sounds
there's always another policy to contradict what you're saying.
It sounds amusing now. I mean, it makes me
it's
laugh.
Hell.
But in reality, when you are there, this is how it goes. Do that right now. Sir, I can't because we didn't get any money. You're fucking counterintention. Do it right now. You're in lower conditions. You're going to the rehabilitation project force. You know, you're going to eat in the stairwell. You're on beans and rice. You fucking get it done. Like, that's what it is.
So much profanity.
Yeah.
That it's unbelievable.
One day they had a newspaper or someone come to do a story, and it was supposed to be a good story on Scientology. So all the staff were brought into a room and told, no swearing today, no swearing. I know swearing is how we get things done. Ron Norton said this. I know swearing is used a lot, and it's how we do things, ha-ha, and chuckles, and we have to use it to get things done. That's how we get things done around here. But just, you know, for public relations reasons, today don't swear. So, I mean, you have, like, these people, and there are some people, and there's an organization called the Commodore's Messenger Organization. They have the authority. If they don't like what you say to them or didn't get something done for them, they have the authority to immediately send you to what's called the Rehabilitation Project Force, which for a year or two or longer, You will wear all black. You will run everywhere you go. You will not speak to anybody. You will eat crappy food. You'll get paid $6 a week or like a quarter of whatever everyone else gets paid. You'll have to repent. You'll have to, you know, say you did everything wrong. You'll have to do endless confessionals. And people, my brother was on this for I think a year and a half before they said, oh, we made a mistake in sending you to it. But other people are on it for 3 years. Some people have been on it for 6 years before they were allowed off. They're allowed to send you immediately. So they come and say, get this done right now. And they're not even your senior. They're just someone else entirely trying to get something else done, but they have like ultimate authority. They're supposed to be L. Ron Hubbard's word on everything. So they come into an office, Astra, what are you doing? Oh, sir, you know, I'm doing this. Well, where's this product? I didn't get to it. Well, fucking get it done. You're counterintention. Fuck you. You know, go to ethics, write up your OWs. You are not going home until this is done. You know, that was what it was like. That was my life for like 4.5 years. You could be doing a good job on what you're doing, but if you didn't do something for them, they could just scream at you and no one could do anything and you couldn't report them.
How did you survive?
I don't know. I just went more and more crazy. That's why I said I got to the point where I was suicidal because I was terrified. Just more and more and more and more. I just went more and more crazy. But in a way, you get used to it. But in a way, you never get used to it because you... I mean, I guess I got used to it. You know, and I thought it was, you know, just the way it was. And I just kept hoping. We were always in a condition of, like, we were always being told we weren't getting our job done, the whole building, the whole organization. We weren't getting our job done. We weren't expanding Scientology. Scientology wasn't expanding. We had to handle it. But we always kind of had the idea that it was going to soon change. We were going to change it, and then everything would be okay, and we wouldn't be yelled at all the time.
Where
and we
was this
get
coming
in trouble.
From? Was this coming from RTC?
Mm-hmm. And,
from the CMO?
Yeah, yeah. We would have briefings. We had two reorganizations where I was there, where they reorganized everything, and they said... you know, it's not expanding under you guys, we're going to do this. Everyone, like, got assigned a lower condition. Like, you're all in treason.
And the whole building.
Yeah, and we ran it for like a year. And no one was allowed to take a day off. You know, no one was allowed anything for like a year.
Let me ask you something, Astra. This is all going on at the management level, but the public Scientologists are not aware of this at all, are they?
No.
How is that, how do they manage to keep the public Scientologists from finding out what it's really like?
We were made to, like, drill. I'll explain, like, what we did. Everyone would go into a room, we would be briefed. You are not allowed to tell anybody what is going on here. If you have a pop, you're not allowed to say it. If you have anything going on, you're not allowed to tell them. If you disagree with anything, you can't say anything. All you can do is write a report on it. Even if your spouse or brother or sister or friend is in a lower level organization, you can't tell them anything. Under no circumstances can you tell your family anything. Then they would have us pair up, and one of us say, you'd pretend to be my father. And you'd say, Astra, how's school going? And I would have to give my answer, an acceptable answer. Oh, I'm going to school, it's wonderful. Astra, aren't you working kind of long hours? No, I'm not, you know, we get off at this time and it's all legal and it's all good and I love work anyway. But, you know, we probably shouldn't talk about it or change the subject.
So you're drilling out a lot of people.
We're getting regularly drilled on how to lie. And if you didn't lie, if I told my dad I'm not going to school, I'm working with these really long hours and I think it's illegal, I'm not happy, anything like that. Or just anything that's going on is considered high-level security, you're not allowed to tell anybody, you know. So if I had said anything, I would have been assigned the condition of treason, which is what you get assigned for out security. I would have had to do amends. And if I kept doing it, I would have ended up on the Rehabilitation Project Force.
Do you have something you wanted to add
to
that?
Well, at least with me, but I know this is other people, you get into such a state of mind like, oh, we're clearing the planet and all this. And it's like your own well-being is so unimportant that the Sea Org's image is your image. And I remember like, people ask me about it, public Scientologists, and I would kind of like totally protect her. I was like a protective mother. Like, even if I lived in the worst place, like someone asked me, you know, that was thinking of getting recruited, asked me about it, I'd be like, you know, they're nice rooms. Oh, yeah. Oh, it's good food. And, you know, I'm friends with everyone. My life is, you know, going so well. And, you know, I have such a better education right now than the public schools. Have you heard what's happening in public schools? I mean, we're just the top people on the planet.
But this isn't true.
No, well, no. I would know I was lying because I felt like everyone had to think that the Sea Org was so good and everyone had to respect Scientology because it was this, like, it was the most important thing on the planet. And
I don't know. She'd been indoctrinated since she was born.
Since I was born. So for me, it was like, oh, I was protecting them.
That's all she grew up knowing.
And everyone had to understand how important and how they should respect.
I would like to say, though, that as Astra's father, I was on the receiving end of this. And so, but I didn't actually know that Astra was totally prohibited from seeing me. So that I knew, she mentioned that she would collect the statistics. So literally every Thursday night, she would have to stay up all night. But then she was allowed to sleep in like Friday morning, right?
Right.
So then she would sneak round, because I bought her a car, so partly so that I could get to see her. She would sneak round every Friday morning and visit with me, because we were close as a father and daughter. And then when she went into the Sea Org, I had extracted promises. I said, well, you must finish your education, you know, and I've heard these horror stories about people working all night, and I used to, and I want you to get proper sleep. I want you to get proper nutrition. I was promised all these things by her and her senior. So every Friday morning I would say, Astra, you know, how's school? And she'd say, fine. And I'd say, you know, what did you study? Oh, math. You know, how's your sleep? Fine. So I knew that I was being BS'd, basically. I could just sense it. But I didn't dare say, come on, why don't you tell me the truth? What's going on? Because, you know, Astra, she seems so into it. I was just afraid that I would be cut off as a parent, that I wouldn't see
barrier,
her again.
There's some barrier, isn't there?
There's a barrier.
There's some barrier that everyone is afraid
and
to cross.
And it's true. It's true because I was terrified of being told I could never see him anymore, so I didn't want him to say anything to me that I would know what they would consider bad.
And eventually your
fear came
true.
Because then I'd have to admit it. And then I'd be told I could never see him again. So I wanted him to think I was doing okay.
So everybody's play acting with everything.
Yeah.
Plus,
everybody's afraid to say what they're honestly
saying. And I'll tell you, what that does to your mind is just unbelievable. You no longer know what is going on in your mind. You no longer know how you feel. You no longer know what's true, what's black, what's white. You don't know anything. I had no idea. My mind was just a mess.
And then she would, because I was what they call disaffected at this point, I paid lip service to Scientology, but I personally no longer liked it, no longer had any intention of spending more money on it. And so then I would ask Astra a few questions about school and her health, and then she would immediately switch to, Dad, you need to get back on course. Dad, you need to buy more auditing.
Well, this was
Dad.
My drilling of what to
do. And I would then say, my part. I would then say, oh, Astra, yes, I've just, you know, worked really hard, and I just, you know, I fully intend to do more auditing. Because, you know, I hated lying, and I hated being a part of it, but I was just terrified that both of my daughters were in the Sea Org. And I'd heard so many horror stories of parents who just never saw their children disappeared.
Well, and the stories are true.
Yeah,
because I used to sneak off to see him. I wasn't allowed to see him, and I wasn't really allowed to have the car. But I lied and said I paid for the insurance myself, and it was all mine. So if they'd known he paid for the insurance and stuff, that's an external influence. So I was questioned about that by RTC.
How do you think these people have managed to gain such an incredible degree of control over people like you and you?
Oh, it's very gradual.
It's gradual, and then it's very easy to do with the people who have family in it, because that's right over your head. You know, like I couldn't just walk away because my family was in it and they never talked to me again. And after time, I mean, it's okay, it's the thing where you think everything's your fault and you're a bad person and you don't want to be a bad person. You don't want everyone to look at you badly. You don't want your family to never speak to you again. And you really do think that this organization, even though, you know, you think they're saving mankind and you just think we're going through like a rough time right now, but it's our fault and we need to handle it. And I always had this thought, like, soon it will get better. Soon we will save mankind and we won't get in trouble all the time, you know? Soon things will smooth over, soon we'll be getting Scientology expanded all over the planet, and you know, and then no longer will everyone be yelling at us all the time.
Why do you suppose the three of you were able to see the truth of the situation, and your mother obviously hasn't?
Well, we've talked about it, like, between the three of us to kind of try and figure it out, because for me personally, the whole time I was there, a little voice in the back of my mind was saying to me, why is this all true, what Scientology says, just because they say so? If I had been born into, you know, Christian religion, any other religion, another cult, you know, what they would be saying would be true. So why is this true, just because I was born into it? I think with my mom, her mom's in Scientology. Her mom's in the organization. And I think my mom always was trying to please her mom because her older sister was very successful and she wasn't like her older sister, so she's always trying to please her mom. I think that's how she got, I don't know, you know, this is just my assumption.
Yeah, we can't be sure.
Mm-hmm. And then when she came into the C organization, she kept moving up and up and up onto higher posts, and that made her very important, and she got a lot of importance out of that. And, I mean, she was known and is known in the C organization for being even more fanatical than most.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
She'll scream and yell at people. She'll really, really get into things, even more than a lot of the other C Org members.
In the early days of the C organization, she'd been on the L. Ron Hubbard had gone around the Mediterranean on a ship called the Apollo. And so she'd been on that ship with Hubbard, and she'd met him, and so... She was really caught up in it.
So and she had been in the Sea Org, and then she was out of the Sea Org, and then she went back in?
Well, actually, I think she'd sent there, she'd been a student, and she'd been sent there for training, not specifically in the Sea Org, mm-hmm. but she'd met Hubbard, so that had a huge impact on her. And her attitude was, you know, this man Hubbard is so great, so wonderful, and if only you'd met him, you know, you'd want to do everything you could to help Scientology. And so I would, but I had a kind of a curiosity in my mind. I would ask her, you know, tell me about the upper levels of Scientology, you know, and why is it you people hate psychiatrists? You know, I've met some psychiatrists. I think they're nice people. I think they want to help people. And she would like, how dare you say that? How dare you question?
Was it before you were a Scientologist?
No, I think, well, I'd done some courses, and so, you know, but nothing...
But you weren't yet...
I wasn't yet really into it, right.
But we got, you were getting into.
Right, but we were married, and so, you know, I thought there'd be like an open exchange of ideas, but really, she was shut off, you know.
So she was already a dedicated Scientologist
exactly,
before
yeah.
you even met her.
Yeah,
and
right.
then did you meet because you came in and started taking these courses?
Yes, yeah, exactly. And then we started to date, and you know, I always admired her because she'd done, you know, the higher levels, and she was so well highly trained.
And what do you think attracted her to you?
At the time, I was one of the few people in the, I mean, I'd graduated in architecture, I had a job, I had a car, I had a place to live, and...
These
honestly,
things were appealing.
These things, no one else really in the London organization... you know, had those things, had prospects, had a job, you know, they were all living hand to mouth. And so I think she just saw that I was some kind of meal ticket. You know, she wasn't actually working. You know, she didn't have a proper job.
My mom was living, she was having some strange people watch Matthew because she couldn't afford to pay for him to go to proper daycare. She was having to borrow money from her parents because she wasn't making any money working at the London Org because they didn't make a lot of money. You know, she was totally stretched thin, and then along comes my dad,
yeah.
who, you know.
I mean, with my mother, I've always thought that she kind of felt a responsibility towards having us raised in the Sea Org, because, like, when you, okay, you're not even if you're on the same level in Scientology, like spiritual training, you're not allowed to talk about it with anyone. And she was already way ahead of my father in spiritual training. And it's kind of like a barrier there because there's things you can't talk about, and it kind of puts a strain on the relationship just because you can't talk about them, or there's things one person knows and the other one doesn't. So she kind of was like, I guess her attitude was like, oh, I know this and this, and they just don't know it.
Well, you feel a bit superior, don't you?
Yeah, totally. So that's what I think.
Tell me what a typical day was like for you.
I'd have to get up at about 7. Leave at 7:30, rush and eat breakfast, and all the staff ate breakfast at the same time. And there was only enough room for the staff, like a third of the staff at a time, to eat. But for breakfast, everyone ate at the same time.
Was this at the complex?
No, this was at the Hollywood Guarantee building.
So you'd take a bus from the complex?
I lived, for a period, I lived at the Anthony building, which is near the complex. So then it's like a 15-minute bus ride to the HGB. Then I lived at the Hollywood Inn, which was on Hollywood Boulevard, which was like about 10 blocks down the road. So then at 8, work started. Then we'd have half an hour for lunch at about 11:30 to 12. And then it would be work until 5:30. Our schedule changed, but it was always half an hour lunch, 45 minutes dinner. unless we were in lower conditions or there's something going on, then our meal times would be shortened even more. And on a regular basis, you didn't take your full meal break. Most people didn't take their full meal break ever or a lot of the time. Just because your senior said, you have to work, you have to finish this before you can go to dinner. That was a regular thing. You have to finish this before you can go to dinner. You have to finish this before you can go home. So, but the schedule was half an hour for lunch, 45 minutes for dinner, and then 10:30 go home. And that was every single day. On Saturday, instead of working our regular jobs, we did renovations, like painting, putting new pipes in, etc., for like fixing up the building we worked in or we lived in. And then on Sunday, we had until 1 in the afternoon to do our laundry and to clean our room. We used to be able to use that time to do other things. We weren't really allowed to, but we would. And then they got very strict and made a new rule. Absolutely could not go anywhere, do anything other than doing your laundry. And the parents who had children up at the ranch, which is an hour and a half away, were using that time to go up and see their children. And they were told, you cannot do that anymore. The only way they could ever see their children is if they got a day off. And people would go for a year without getting a day off. Yeah, the Pack Ranch.
Where's the Pack Ranch?
It's in Valencia, up in like the hills. It's about an hour and a half drive by bus.
So these are the parents with in Pack in the LA area?
Yeah, with children. And that's where the children were taken. This was later. They were taken there.
And parents would go for a year without seeing their children?
People would go for a year without taking a day off. And they weren't. Sometimes they'd bring the kids down to work, so once in a while they'd see them. But parents went for months and months without seeing their children. One lady, when I was the director of inspections and reports, one lady's daughter said she wanted to kill herself because she missed her mom and other things so much. She said she wanted to kill herself. Her mom obviously got very afraid and said, I need to go up there. Her senior said, you can't go. She went anyway and got in huge trouble and was sent to me to be handled for doing this, for leaving. And she was told she had blown, which means you leave without permission, and that's a big deal, like a huge deal. I thought it was sickening. I thought it was so sickening. I couldn't even understand it.
I just want to say, I myself had suicide thoughts, but I would never, ever say them. You know, it was like a secret for me because in Scientology, if you think of suicide or you think of committing it, you're a very bad person.
You're crazy.
So, yeah, you're just crazy. So I had like some thoughts when things were really going downhill for me, and I never admitted them, but for the girl to actually admit them, knowing the label that would be put on her, I mean, she obviously had to be going through a lot. And I mean, I wish I had had one of my parents come down and talk to me about that. I mean, I can just imagine the situation that girl was in. I think it's horrible.
Yeah.
So then that was our basic day, 8 to 10:30. But that wasn't really your basic day because you almost always worked later. They said the minors weren't supposed to work past 10. Really, the minors, depending on their age, weren't either supposed to work at all or weren't supposed to work more than 3 hours a day. But they said, okay, well, the minors have to stop working at 10 and everyone else at 10:30. But really, you could work till 11, 12, 1, 2, 3. There was one period when I was still, I think I was 16 or 17, and they were doing this whole new thing where they were writing all these new policies, and all the staff had to stay up night and day printing the new policies and putting them in books, etc., because there was going to be a big event where it's going to be released to everybody. And we literally, it's hard for me to even believe, I don't even know how we did it, did not sleep for weeks, about 3 weeks from what I remember. The only sleep we got was we'd fall asleep or be allowed to go home for 2 hours. My job was to go wake everyone up. I was driving around falling asleep in my car, and I wasn't even 18. I wasn't even supposed to be working, you know, more than a few hours a day. Sometimes we went for 2 or 3 days with no sleep, and then we'd be allowed to sleep for a couple hours and we had to come back in. And literally I got an average of an hour or two sleep a night. I was delirious. So was everyone else. We'd fall asleep while we were eating, like just blabbering. So, but on a regular basis, we had to stay up late. Every Thursday night we had to stay up till 3 and then sleep till noon because we had to get all the statistics in.
So that they could be sent up to
the executives. Yeah, mm-hmm. Exactly. And we had to compile them all. And that was another time where I got yelled and screamed at because every week we had to get about 300 different organizations to report. And they each had to report like...
This was from all over the world.
Yeah, and they had to report like 50 to 200 statistics. And every week, of course, someone didn't report. Someone went home without reporting. Someone forgot. Someone was late. And it was just unbelievable what would happen to us. We had this system where every week we had to do something that was like instant messaging back and forth with the executives up at INS. And it would get to the point where they would be saying, F you this, you know, saying every swear word you can think of, telling me that I was counterintention, telling me that I was stopping it from happening, that they were going to send me to ethics. They would then call down and scream, you know, and it was really, 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 really hard
to
deal with.
Can you recreate one of those screaming telephone calls?
Well, I can't do the girl's accent because she had a foreign accent, but she was like, Astra, what the fuck are you doing? Get these statistics. You're stopping COB. You know, things like that. In the morning, she would start off.
Is David Miscavige.
Yeah, you're stopping COB. I need the statistics for him, you know. I don't know what she looked like. I never met her. In the morning, she would start off really nice. Hi, Astra, how are you doing? You know, good morning. Let's get this done on time. As soon as it wasn't on time.
But she was getting screamed at.
She was getting screamed at, of course. And the other thing was, there was nothing I could do. This is another thing of, like, you go around in a circle. I was not allowed to call to tell them. So we had another division that was sort of allowed to call per one policy, but not really. They called. But there was never enough money to call. They didn't want to call. They called, but they didn't send them. So they said, oh, you know. It was just unbelievable. I've been like screamed at, sworn at, called all these names, told, you know, I'm stopping it, but there was nothing I could do. I could send a telex, which they may not even get. I could tell someone to call them, and then they'd call them. So everyone was just yelling at everyone.
And all of these statistics were going up to COB, which is David Miscavige.
Yeah, so they could see how much money was made total every week, how many staff there were every week. You know, monitor. We had to compile everything and make graphs on the computer. We had to print them all off. We had to do all kinds of stuff.
Mm-hmm. I just want to say that statistics in all Scientology organizations are important. Even in the cadet org, which you think would not be that important, I mean, it was like this lowly children's org, we would get yelled at, like, if because the cadet coordinator would say, we have to report our statistics to INT or to her org, FLO, and they would get angry because I wouldn't have the statistics. We kept counting them wrong, and we didn't even know proper math to figure them out and do the graph, so statistics are a big deal.
It's because there's a policy from L. Ron Hubbard saying, basically, you know, if your statistics are up, you know, if they're going, each week you're supposed to do more than you did the last week, and you're in big trouble if you didn't. So if you write letters, every week you have to write more letters. You get to a point where you can't write more letters, but that doesn't matter. So when I first went into the Sierra when I was 14, school was on Saturday. And it was about 6 hours a day on Saturday, and that was it. And they knew that the minimum requirement for school is 20 hours, but it was just ignored.
6 hours a week?
A week.
That was it.
Sorry, 6 hours a week on Saturday. That was it. That was the only school you got. And we were all in one room, and we had a supervisor. He wasn't a teacher. He wasn't trained at all as a teacher. He was just trained as a Scientology supervisor. And we didn't have materials. We didn't have enough books. We just literally, like, sit around, read books, talk, do nothing, really. And I started going to school less and less because on my job, first I was a receptionist. I wasn't allowed to go anywhere without someone, you know, covering the receptionist post. So I had to find someone every week to do that, and that was hard. Then when I was the director of inspections and reports, I would go to school and people would say, well, who's covering your post?
Right.
You know, who's doing your job for you while you're at school? You have to figure it out. And
of course, nobody was able to do that.
Yeah, exactly, for a whole day. I mean, everyone's being screamed at for not getting their stuff done. They're not going to go off and do someone else's stuff for 6 hours. And it was pointless as well because we weren't actually doing school. We were just kind of, you know, it was so disorganized. It's unbelievable. I kept going. They changed it several times. We moved. For a while, we went up to the pack ranch where the kids are. So that meant an hour and a half there and an hour and a half back. So 3 hours were taken out of the school that we did do. Because our school would be from like 9 in the morning till I think like 4 in the afternoon. And then part of that was driving up there. So it got to be even less. And then they moved it. Then they decided we have to have the school in the building where you work. So all of us were in one room. with another supervisor, not a teacher at all, never taught in her life from what I know. And she had nothing for us to do. She had no idea what to do. So all of us, you know, kids from the age of like 12 to 17, were doing spelling bees, math bees, just sitting around. And then we go to the park, just killing time for a legal requirement that wasn't even being met, not even close, 6 hours when you're supposed to get at least 20.
And Scientology can get away with this because nobody's going to go report anything to the authorities because they'll be declared suppressive.
Declared instantly. Yeah. I wondered so many times, why aren't people from the Labor Department coming here and inspecting? Why are we only getting 6 hours of school? The people from OSA, the legal department in Scientology, were saying, you know, we know it's illegal for these children to be working this long, and we know it's illegal for them not to be getting 20 hours of school, and they really should, but it's not being done.
How do you know the people from legal and OSA were saying
because
that?
Because when I was the DIR in ITO and the DIR in the FLO, part of my job was like the legal...
Rudes.
Yeah, I was...
Rudiments,
yeah,
the basics.
Yeah, I was like the liaison for any legal points between my organization and OSA.
Mm-hmm.
Not all the time, because they kept reorganizing, but some of the time. Didn't mean I could actually do anything, but it meant I got told these things.
Mm-hmm.
They were just discussed.
You just heard.
One time, the only... Well, they did the thing where they said all the minors have to leave at 10 instead of 10:30. I mean, it's completely irrelevant. And then the kids that were really young, there was a boy who was 12 and a girl who was like 13, and a couple other kids who were 12 or 13 were sent to the pack ranch. But then one of them was brought back anyway. But this didn't, you know, it was just a couple kids who were super young, and they looked really young too. Like mm-hmm. this little boy was, you know, like this tall, and he worked at the computer all day. So they finally decided they could get in trouble for that, and they sent him away, but he was going to be brought back a year or two later. I went to school less and less and less and less until I finally stopped going and no one cared.
Why do you think the Labor Department never came? Do you think it was just covered up so well?
Because no one ever reported it. I just don't think anyone has, because the kids I know who have left who would report it are still in Scientology.
So they won't be going to the authorities?
No.
There was an inspection in Florida way before I even went to the cadet org where they went and they inspected the kids for bruises because someone had told them. One person had told them. So they went and they inspected them all and they questioned them all.
Somebody had told them what? That they were being
abused? Yeah, some children were being abused. But the people had already kind of like made sure the kids knew what to say to anyone that asked. So the kids were like, oh, no.
They were drilled.
Yeah.
Well, if you had been asked...
I would have been like, what? Oh, the school's great. Yeah, I go to school all the time. I'm learning such new subjects.
There was also... there was no... real way to handle harassment, because harassment was very common. Being, you know, people yelling at you and swearing at you is harassment, but that was the way things were done. So you couldn't say I'm being harassed from that point of view.
There's no place to go to report it.
No. When I was first in this year, I think I was still 14. One of the long-term staff members named David Rousseau. He's been in this year since pretty much the beginning of this year.
I know DR.
Yeah, he slapped me on the butt. He said, how you doing, or something like that. And I was like, oh, my God, but there's nothing I could do. He was an officer with rank. I had to call him sir. And there was nothing I could do about it. And mm-hmm. I was 14 years old, and he's, like, smacking my butt. And then later on, a couple years later, there's a man named Jeff Porter, who's the Security Chief International. And he is a very angry person. And several times he just, like, yelled and screamed at me. I was terrified of this person. One day he came and told me to do something. He told me I had to get a bunch of staff to do security for an event. That wasn't my job. So he came back a few hours later. He said, did you do it? And I said, well, you know, it's really not my job. He held me up against a wall, screamed at me. He was right here in my face, screaming and swearing and spitting in my face and holding me up against the wall. Then I complained to the staff chaplain. All the staff chaplain did was sit us down in a room and say what happened, and I told my story, and Jeff Porter said, she didn't do this, I ordered her to do it, and it just went nowhere, and it was dropped. And yet,
we're always, Scientology staff members are always, and all Scientologists are always told, you have to handle it within the organization.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You can't go. The worst thing a Scientologist can do is to go outside the organization to handle anything.
I couldn't even tell my dad, let alone the authorities, you know. I would have been in huge trouble for saying to my dad or saying to anybody.
Right, and yet within the organization, there's no place to go.
Right.
There's no recourse.
Yeah. I mean, you can write reports, but you got to be careful how you word them.
Because you'll get in more trouble than the person you're
reporting. One girl wrote a report, a friend of mine. A mission was fired in, and a mission's fired in when an organization supposedly isn't doing well. Then they send people from a higher organization in to handle, and then everyone in the organization is in ethics trouble. They're all made to work late, et cetera. It's like this, you know, terrorization thing. She didn't agree with something one of the people on the mission did. She wrote a report on it. She went to the RPF, the Rehabilitation Project Force, immediately.
Just for that?
A year later, they said, oh, that was a mistake, and they let her off. And she then got pregnant and left. But that's like the kind of stuff that could happen, so you had to be really careful. Like, you couldn't dare write a report on the senior executive.
And yet policy says...
Yeah, and I did want to write a report because for the year before I left, I was in data, and I was in charge of the statistics. My senior...
And data is one of the departments, isn't
it? Yeah, it's all for... They make a copy of every letter that comes into the organization and put it in the computer. That means personal letters, any letters. Every letter that comes in gets opened and put in the computer, a copy of it, and people can read it. My direct senior's name, he was like my boss right over me, his name was Wayne Furness. He didn't like me. As soon as I started working there, he didn't like me. I had a friend there, and we worked together, and one day he started calling us lesbians for absolutely no reason. He's like, you guys are lesbians, and for the next few weeks, every time he saw us, he referred to us as lesbians. And I kept telling him, don't do that, it's not okay, you know? And he wouldn't stop. He thought it was really funny. So I finally did report it. I reported it to his senior. And he did get in trouble for it. She told him, you can't call her a lesbian. Don't do that anymore. So for the rest of the year that I worked there, he called me every other name other than a lesbian. He called me... He said, okay, first he started off saying I had soft skin. And there were about 10 other people in the department, about 8. And he told all of them I had soft skin, and it became a big joke. Astra has soft skin. She can't take being teased. Then he called me two-ton Tessie for no reason because I'm not overweight, but he decided to call me two-ton Tessie. He'd just come up with names to call me and come up with arguments. And every time I would get upset, he would say, you're getting upset because of your overts and withholds. Go to ethics.
And your soft skin.
I couldn't do anything about it because in our department we were producing a lot and our statistics were going up. And the policy is that if your statistics are up, you can't get in trouble. So he couldn't get in trouble for it.
Mm-hmm.
And there was someone finally did an investigation where they asked questions about it because I got really upset about it, but nothing was done. So he continued to the day I left making fun of me and calling me names. And there was nothing I could do. I would cry. I would get upset. And then he got the other staff to agree with him and call me names. So he would say, oh, two-ton Tessie. And I'd say, don't call me that. And then the other staff would go, you have soft skin, you know?
And I just want to add that being like a lesbian or gay in the church, or especially in the Sea Org, is considered a really bad thing.
Yeah.
Like, you're considered, you're sexually weird. And you must have done horrible things to now, you know, have changed yourself so weirdly to become gay. So it wasn't only like that you weren't gay, it was like that it put such a horrible name.
It was a very
bad name to be called, because everyone looked at you like, oh my god, could she be gay?
Yeah. You have to write up your whole life history information, and a lot of people have access to that, and your senior would have access to that. It implied, even
though
I didn't,
something.
It implied that he had seen something, he knew something about my prior history. Because you write up your life history, you go in session, you write up your overts and withholds. These go in your ethics file, they go in your personnel file, and they go in your PC file. People have access to these. Anyone pretty much can read them. They're not kept locked up, hardly. Some of them are, but anyone. Your senior can get into any of them. People from ethics can get into any of them, and anyone senior to you can get into any of them and read any of them. They can go into your PC folder and read your most intimate thoughts that you told your auditor that are supposed to be kept confidential.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so there was nothing I could do about him. So I just kind of lived with it. And that drove me crazy for a year. I was just being insulted, made fun of, and harassed for no reason. And there was nothing I could do.
Mm-hmm. What about when you visited the Mace Kingsley Ranch School?
Before I was in the Sea Organization, I was about 13. And there was a place called the Mace Kingsley Ranch. It was in Palmdale, about 30 minutes outside of Los Angeles. And it was run by a man named Wally Hanks, who was OT7. He was like one of the highest level Scientologists. He was very well known and revered. And he used to do briefings to people on how to handle their children. And a lot of the children at the Mace Kingsley Ranch were considered problem children. Their parents had gone into the Sea Org and they wouldn't go. Or their parents were in Scientology, they didn't want to be in Scientology. Or for one reason or another, they were considered a problem child. I never was sent there, but I had friends who were. And I went up to visit them a few times. Now, when I went up to visit them, I found out what happened was anyone who acted up, like a boy was found peeping in the girls' room. And just any time you did something wrong, you were paddled. Wally was a very big man, and he had a paddle. And all of us would sit around. This happened the first time I went up there to visit. Sit around on the sofa, and the person who's being paddled stood in the middle of the room, and Wally would paddle them with this paddle. It would make them cry. And then he would put a little notch on it for paddling them. And that was the punishment. In the evenings, he would build a bonfire and give all the girls and all the boys beer. I was 13 years old, 14, I think it was 13. Everyone had beer and got drunk. I think the first night or the second night I was up there, I was sitting next to him, and I had had a few beers, and so had he, and so had everyone else, and he put his hand on my shirt and down my bra and started feeling me. And it really scared me. And I asked my friend later, I said, "What's Wally doing? Why did he do this?" And she said, "Oh, don't worry. He just does that with the girls. That's just what he does, but don't worry about it."
This guy is running the school?
Yeah, he ran it. He, from what I know, he owned it, and he definitely ran it with his wife. Another night, he took us camping, and we went out, and we had more beer, and we were camping. And once we'd all had a few drinks, he gave us guns to go practice shooting. So I sat in the dark with a flashlight and a gun, practiced shooting at like cans and things after I'd had a few beers
to drink. What kind of guns?
Just like handguns. Oh, and rifles. We did rifles earlier in the day before we drank, and then we did handguns in the evening. That one time that he put his hand on my shirt was the only time he did that to me, but later on, when I was in the SEA organization, when I was the director of inspections and reports, I came across some reports on him. He had been found out that he'd been doing these things, but he had done a lot worse than what he'd done to me. He had really badly molested several girls.
How do you mean?
Like, felt down their pants and had them pee on his car or on someone's car. And just,
what do you mean, pee on the car?
He got off by seeing them pee on cars. Told them to pee on cars, and they would do it for him because they had to. Or
they might be drunk.
He got them drunk, had them pee on cars,
God.
Felt them, and I don't know if he actually had intercourse. I don't remember if he actually had intercourse with anyone, but, you know, up to that point, really bad molested.
What happened? What happened to him?
Well, because he was an OT7, they said they weren't going to declare him officially because it would be bad public relations for people to hear that an OT7 molested children and got declared. So they quietly ousted him from the church. They quietly said he's declared.
But did they report him to the authorities?
No, they never reported him. At least not to my knowledge. These reports said nothing about it. They said it was a handling. It's like he's been doing this, and what we're going to do is we're going to oust him, but we're not going to officially declare him. We're not going to tell people about it because it's bad public relations because he was an OT7.
What about the parents of the girls who were molested? Did they do anything about this?
I don't know about that. I don't know what happened. One of the girls was in the Sea Org with me and left, and another one of the girls is still a Scientologist. They're all still Scientologists. The parents probably were told, well, we're ousting him for the church. And that's considered a handling.
Incredible.
There was another case of that. Before I came to the QI, like the second time, there had been a cadet coordinator there. I've forgotten his name. I mean, I never even met him. But my friend was later telling me how he had molested her. She'd come in with a cut on her leg to his office saying, "Can you fix this? Do you have a band-aid?" And he sat her down, and he also felt her up, found her pants. She had been, like, I think 11 at that time. And she finally told her mom, and her mom told, like, her mom was totally outraged, and her mom told the church authorities, and they took him off the post of cadet coordinator. I think they put him on the rehabilitation project force, and that was it. He didn't get anything else. They wouldn't report that to the authorities because it would bring attention to their school and it would be bad publicity for Scientology.
There was another case, too. When I was in the cadet org at Flag, I remember I was about 8. There was a girl who was there who was maybe 13 or 14, maybe 15 or 16. And one of the men, who was an older man, maybe in his 30s, he was in charge of the kids, I think. Or he had another job. I don't remember because I was so young. But I remember this happening. He had an affair with her, and she was underage. And he got ousted but not reported. Because I remember I saw
with
him later.
With a 15-year-old.
He was like a taxi driver, 15 or 16. Definitely not. He was in big trouble because she was underage, and then you're not allowed to do anything before you're married, and she was underage, but never reported because they just ousted him. They just kicked him out. But they don't want to get in trouble for it, you know, because they're liable for this kind of stuff. Same with the lady who poisoned the little child in L.A. They sent her to the Rehabilitation Project Force instead of reporting her to the authorities because they didn't want the bad public relations.
They often pick, like, the staff members that had, you know, messed up the worst on jobs or had proved the most ineffective and the most irresponsible. They often pick those people to be the nannies and the adults in charge of watching the children, the few adults in charge of watching the children, because the cadet org was considered unimportant and unnecessary, really. Like, it was just children who are taking up their money. And most of the people that watched me came off the Rehabilitation Project Force for doing something wrong, sometimes sexually wrong, sometimes wrong with the Scientology technology, which was considered very bad. So they put the people that they consider really low and like the worst to watch us. I mean, who knows how bad things got?
There's obviously no background checks, no criminal checks, nothing done. They didn't even do their own checks. Like, people who were sent up to INT or people who go to OSA or people who work on, like, the jobs I worked on even, are given special confessionals to make sure they're qualified. They didn't even do their own internal checks on these people. They picked, because it was considered about as important as washing the pots and pans, they put the people they considered the least qualified to watch them. And that was even in a program once. One time they wrote a program to handle it because there was the girl who was suicidal and these other things that were happening. And they were worried they were going to get in trouble legally. They decided they had to do something about it. And it was even written in a program I saw that the people who are the least qualified are the ones put to handle the children.
But the program actually stated this?
It stated that, but they never handled it because it's very typical in Scientology. They write these long programs with these long handlings that are impossible to do, that can't get done because they don't have the resources and they don't have the ability, and all their policies act against each other. The programs never get done.
Mm-hmm.
So it never got sorted out.
I just wonder how many things are going on in Scientology like this that aren't being reported because Scientologists are forbidden to go outside the organization.
I mean, the things I said are just the things I know about, and I certainly don't know everything.
I would guess with children that over 20 instances of molestation or serious abuse of, like, hitting them or, like, slapping them around to unconsciousness have happened. Over 20, I bet.
And then there's the whole point
really
on
serious.
Then there's the whole point on abortion and coercing into abortion. For example, after I left and I had my daughter, my brother's wife got pregnant. She was just a year or two older than me. She was one of my best friends when I was there. She got pregnant so that she could leave, and she thought my brother would go with her. She thought he wanted to leave. She wanted to leave very badly. My brother called me up, and he told me he was trying to convince her to get an abortion. He was very upset because she wouldn't. Why he's telling me this, I don't know. I just had a child. But he's telling me all this, and I was very happy for Dee, even though she's going to go through the same thing of having to raise the baby by herself. I was happy. I knew. I had said to my dad, I said, I know Dee's unhappy, and I know she's going to leave. And a few months later, we heard that she did. And she never said a word, but you can just tell, you know. So she was going to leave, and then she was just going to leave without him because he refused to go with her. He was going to not go. And when she was 4 months pregnant, he called me up and told me, that he had convinced her and she'd gone and gotten her, but he'd taken her to go get an abortion.
He was all happy about
it. And he was happy about it. And he said, at first, this was the day after, he said, at first I was upset, but now I'm okay because I know it was the best thing. Then my mom called, and Zoe was very upset about it, and I was too, but Zoe says to my mom, Matthew or Dee just got an abortion. And my mom says, oh, good.
Yeah, my mom, you could hear relief in her voice. She was like, oh, good, the problem's solved. And I said,
we were just in shock.
I said, Mom, do you realize what you're saying? I was like, Dee got an abortion. I said, on a baby that was half grown. I was like, it had a heartbeat already. It had a fingerprint. And I was like, it would have been Kate's cousin. I kept trying to like describe like how, you know, like she sounded
does this make
like
you feel
someone
anything?
wasn't human. And and she was like, and she instantly kind of changed. She's like, well, you know, these things happen, but it was all for the greatest good. It was all to forward Scientology so Dee could keep working for Scientology. That's all that mattered, even though, you know, a little baby was put to death. I mean, I'm not against all abortion or anything. I just think that in this case, Dee wanted the baby. You know, she purposely got pregnant so she could have this baby and leave. And my brother just ruthlessly went after her and convinced her. And, you know, Asher described her state of mind to me. You know, she was kind of wobbly, and I'm sure that's how Dee was, and he just went after that and went after her vulnerable points and convinced her, and she just had her baby killed.
Kate's so lucky that
nobody
was able to convince
you. Well, I was lucky because I had my dad. I knew I had somewhere to go. She didn't have the support. Plus, she wanted my brother to go with her. She was in love with him. She thought he'd go with her. I was fine. I wanted to leave my husband. We didn't want to be married anymore. So it was very hard for her. She left anyway. I don't know what happened, but I asked one time I asked where is she, because I went to speak to my brother, and they said, oh, she doesn't work here anymore. So I don't know what happened, but I knew of other girls who got abortions. There's an older lady who was about 40, and she already had a couple children who were grown, and they were in the CERG, and she got pregnant, and she's like, oh, I have to get an abortion, and she just went off and got it. And another girl got pregnant, and she had to borrow some $300 to go get an abortion. They were all sent to Planned Parenthood to get the abortions.
Planned Parenthood in LA?
Yeah, yeah. And, I mean, it's not even a matter of pro-choice or pro-life. But, I mean, even if you're pro-choice, it's not a choice when someone's making you do it.
Yeah, it wasn't like
I mean, the law is that you may get an abortion, and, you know, that's fine, because in some cases it's warranted. But if someone's raped or something. But
yeah,
these people
totally
are like
choice.
Wearing you down for months while holding you prisoner, saying you have to get an abortion. And it's just unbelievable to me. It's unbelievable.
It's tragic.
Yeah. I mean, it's the only church that I know of in the world that gets people to get an abortion. It's only because they don't want to deal with the financial difficulty of it.
Or the production distraction.
Yeah. And it's so backwards, because this is another example of the policies conflicting. L. Ron Hubbard says there are 8 dynamics in your life. The second dynamic has to do with family and procreation. And he says that if you don't have all your 8 dynamics, you know, working in alignment, if you're not happy and successful on all of those, you can't survive on any of them. Yet, you're not allowed to have children.
I remember at 12 years old, I was something like, oh, I read the rule, and suddenly I'm 12 years old, and I already know I can't have children.
Yeah.
That was just a shock.
When that rule came out, my post was the director of inspections and reports, and all the staff were put in one room and given a briefing on this new policy. And I was under orders to stand there and look and see who got upset about it, and then take them to ethics and handle them. And that's what I had to do. And there were several people who were like, and I'm sitting here like, I want children, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
Having to handle people on wanting children. It was just unbelievable to me.
Did either of you ever hear anything about Lisa McPherson?
I did keep hearing these rumors, and when the picketers came, I was like, Lisa McPherson, who's that? Even though she had died in the church, it seemed very clearly that they had they had caused her death, but they kept that completely from the staff. I mean, and especially as a cadet, I had no idea. But one day I asked my mother, who was Lisa McPherson? And she said, oh, she was just some crazy girl. She got in a car accident and she ran down the street naked. She said it like that. Like, it didn't matter because she had gone, you know, I don't know, but my mother hated her, it seemed. Like, when she talked about her, she was sneering. And I later found out
that my mother... She just said she's just some crazy
person.
Yeah,
she's some crazy person. And when I later found out on the internet that my mother watched her and was in charge of the people to watch her for her stay in the Fort Harrison. And I could not believe that, because if I had watched a girl, if I had known a girl, I'd watched her and I'd been in charge of people that watched her for days, and later, after that, she died, I would certainly, even if I did think she was crazy, I would certainly never speak of her in terms like that. Never. I mean, I would, you know, I think you should show respect for the dead. And especially if it seemed that your church had caused their death. But my mother sneered.
And then I recently, a few weeks ago, my mother was flown to LA to stop me from doing a newspaper article about Scientology. And she was very verbal in expressing how bad the some of the critics of Scientology were. And I wasn't trying to say anything to her that was mean, because she was my mother, and I was just saying, I don't want to talk about that. I'm doing the article. If you want to speak to me with my mother, that's fine.
Newspaper article.
But she kept pushing me and saying derogatory things to me. So I finally asked her, I said, well, Mom, what about Lisa McPherson? And I said, you watched her, and you were the direct senior of the other people who watched her, and she died. What about that? And she said, well, do you know what she really died of? And I said, I know the story that you're going to give me. The church's story is that she died of a blood clot that she got when she was hit by the car and later died of the blood clot. And I said, but I've seen the autopsy photos. I've seen the reports. I know that she died of dehydration and et cetera.
She had bruises all over
that
her.
Yeah, she had bites on her and bruises, et cetera. And she said to me, I said, don't you have any remorse? She died. Don't you feel bad? And she wouldn't say she felt bad. She just kept saying, then she went into the, well, she was crazy. She got hit by a car. She took off her clothes. And then she said, well, she was put in a psychiatric institute. Did you want that? Because Scientology hates psychiatry.
You know that's not true. She wasn't put in a psychiatric institute.
Right.
But, she was taken to the hospital.
Right, yeah. And put in, like, the mental ward of the hospital or something.
They were trying to treat her.
Yeah, exactly. Sure. Well, I don't have anything against that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not at all. That's where she should have been. She, a poor girl, she needed help, you know. It's like, if that's not a cry for help, what is? So she said to me, she was put in a psychiatric institute. Is that what you wanted? And I said, Mom, she died. Anything would have been better than that. She's dead. That's the result of what you did, is she's dead. Don't you feel bad about it? She wouldn't answer me. She wouldn't answer. She wouldn't. She couldn't admit she was wrong, because I later found out, I assumed and then found out, that she was reporting back every word I said to her back to OSA. Because OSA told the reporter who did our story, she told her, OSA told the reporter the things my mom had told them. So she had been reporting back everything I told her. So she couldn't admit any wrong.
Well.
Because then I would tell the reporter she admitted that, you know, it was wrong. And she
yeah.
wouldn't admit it.
And she would have gotten in a lot of trouble.
And
for
I know that.
That
David Miscavige made a statement saying, we're very sorry for what happened, and if we had the chance to do it differently, we would. But that's not really how they felt. Because my mom couldn't even say to me, yeah, we made a mistake. It was just, she was a crazy woman. She was put in a psych institute. We took her out. She died of a blood clot.
Well,
and I'm sure that's what my mom believes.
But maybe you got her thinking.
I hope so.
Maybe you got her
because
thinking.
Then I said to her, Mom, something's wrong here. I wanted to kill myself. Zoe wanted to kill herself. We were miserable for years. We're your children. Does that make you feel bad? I was trying to get to her. I was almost crying. I was like, does this have any effect on you? I wanted to kill myself. I'm your daughter. I hated it so much. I was so miserable. I am now so happy, happier than I've ever been in my life. I have a beautiful daughter. I'm doing what I want to do. Something must have been wrong with Scientology. Something must have been wrong.
No, it must have been wrong with us.
She just said nothing. She just stared at me. And that was one of the last times I saw her. So
Well, you two are awfully lucky.
Yeah.
I think you have so. Your lives back.
Yeah. And we have our whole lives ahead of us. Well, I work for my dad, and he has an architectural practice, so I work for him.
What do you do?
Well, for the past couple of years, mainly I've been, he draws up the project, and then I take it down to the city and get approval on it. So I love doing that. I have a lot of fun, and I've met everyone there, and I have a lot of friends that I met doing that. And then I took a class, actually I took it when I was pregnant, on the GED, which is like a high school equivalency. And then I took the exam a while later. I passed really well. I was really happy, actually.
That's great.
I got like, you know, like 99 percentile
scores. Good for you.
So I was really happy with that because I thought that I wouldn't even pass. It's another thing. My mom has said to me, oh, if Scientology technology is so bad, how are you so smart? I mean, I don't think I'm so smart, but I'm very insulted by the fact that she thinks if I have any intelligence, it's because of Scientology. When, you know, the reality is that I'm lucky to have gotten away with any education and any intelligence. And really what it is I studied like crazy to take the GED. I took a course for 6 weeks and I kept studying and I kept reading and I kept doing things and I passed. And then about 6 months ago, I enrolled in my first class in college, in a drafting class. And architectural drafting, and I learned how to do computer-aided drafting. And my instructor told me I was one of the best students he ever had.
Good for you.
And he gave me an A on everything I did on all my assignments. And I'm starting my next class right now. I only have time to do one class at a time, but I'll hopefully have time for more in the future. But 2 mornings a week I go to class, and the rest of the time I work. So my next class starts in a week, and then I'm just going to keep taking one class at a time until Kate's a bit older and she starts school, and then I can work towards getting my degree. And then taking the architectural license exam.
That's great. Yep. How do you feel about your life now?
I feel lucky, really. I mean, for one, I can regret everything that happened, but I have my daughter, and I have my family, so I don't. And I also am in a position to stop other people from going through what I went through. And, you know, I came out alive. No one's injured. And, yeah, I regret missing my childhood. There's nothing that I can never get it back. There's education I can never get back because I'm trying to go forward. So I can't go back and, like, study history that I never learned. But I read the newspaper, I read books, and, you know, so I make it. I get by. And I'm really, really happy. Like, one day I remember I was riding my bike. I had Kate and a little trailer behind. And I was like, I can go and ride a bike whenever I want to. And I was so happy. Just to be able to just ride my bike, and I was like, I can go anywhere. One day I just thought, I want to go to Santa Barbara. It's like 2 hours up the coast. I called a hotel, I made a reservation, I got in the car, I drove up there, and I spent the weekend there with my daughter. It was just like, so I felt so free. It was just like unbelievable, because it's hard to understand for the average person, but you can't do anything. You can't leave the building without permission when you're in the Sea Org. So to be able to drive off and do anything, you know, it's just like unbelievable. And I mean, I think I'm doing well because I'm working on my education. I work. I have my daughter. I have a boyfriend. He knows all about Scientology. He's very supportive. He's got a little daughter too. I'm just really happy now. And Zoe's out. That was like the last thing. And my mother, my grandmother, and my brother never speak to me. Won't ever speak to me again. But that was their choice. So I never said to them, I'm not going to speak to you, but they chose not to speak to me again, and that was their choice. So I can live with that even. I mean, it's upsetting, but, you know, at least I have my sister, I have my dad, and I have Kate, you know, and they're the only ones who have been there for me, so that's what I care about the most. So I'm just happy, happy to be out, happy to have met some other people who have gone through similar experiences, and happy to be able to say anything, to do anything, to help other people who have left or stop other people from getting involved in it before they know what really goes on there.